Hello everyone, I am Dr. Tanvi Desai, consulting obstetrician, gynecologist and laparoscopic surgeon at RxDx Clinics, Bellandur and Siddhapura branch. Today I am going to answer some of your queries regarding PCOS or polycystic ovarian syndrome. Polycystic ovarian syndrome is a common endocrine disorder affecting predominantly women of reproductive age group. But it is also known to affect adolescents and postmenopausal women. It results in excessive production of androgens or male hormones from the ovary and insulin resistance. The underlying cause of this is unknown and still an area of active research. The prevalence of PCOS in India ranges between 3.7 to 22.5%. depending upon the population studied and the criteria used for diagnosis. Polycystic ovarian syndrome is associated with the risk of transmission of various chronic systemic illnesses like cardiovascular disorders, type 2 diabetes, obstructive sleep apnea, miscarriage and also other complications of pregnancy, endometrial hyperplasia and cancers. Hence, it is the need of the hour to spread awareness regarding this condition and associated risk factors. Let me tell you about the risk factors causing PCOS and the symptoms of PCOS. Increased BMI more than 23 kg per meter square, a high waist circumference more than 35 inches, excessive weight gain, intake of high caloric food or high glycemic index, consumption of alcohol, smoking, low physical activity, impaired glucose metabolism and high fasting levels of insulin, or lipid metabolic dysregulation, that is elevated levels of total cholesterol, triglycerides, LDL cholesterol, or a family history of PCOS, diabetes and an inadequate lifestyle are all risk factors associated with development of PCOS. The symptoms of PCOS may range from menstrual irregularity, facial hair, acne, hair loss, infertility to metabolic syndrome. In adolescents, it is associated with psychiatric disturbances like anxiety and depression. How do we come at a diagnosis of PCOS? Ovulatory dysfunction, excess androgen activity, and polycystic ovarian morphology on ultrasound are the three important criteria used to diagnose PCOS. But self-diagnosis is always dangerous. Hence, it would be better that you consult your doctor, who will examine you and then guide you regarding any tests or investigations required to confirm the diagnosis. The European Society of Human Reproduction and Embryology and the American Society of Reproductive Medicine have proposed that a positive observation of two of the above three criteria is important to confirm the diagnosis. But your doctor may ask for certain hormonal tests like luteinizing hormone, follicle stimulating hormone, free testosterone, dehydroepiandrosteronidione, 17-hydroxyprogesterone, thyroid stimulating hormone and prolactin to rule out other endocrine disorders which may be mimicking the symptoms of PCOS. The role of ultrasound is also very important in confirming the diagnosis. The presence of more than 12 follicles ranging from 2 to 9 millimeters in diameter or an ovarian volume of more than 10 ml without the presence of any dominant follicle in at least one ovary between day 2 to day 5 of the cycle is suggestive of a polycystic morphology. Multifollicular ovaries have fewer cysts up to 6 and larger diameter up to 10 millimeters. The presence of multifollicular ovaries is a common feature in adolescents. Hence, while interpreting the ultrasound findings, it is important to strictly differentiate between the two. The use of MRI or magnetic resonance imaging is more accurate in diagnosis of PCO in adolescent patients. will discuss about the treatment options for PCOS. Treatment can be targeted broadly at ameliorating the symptoms of androgen excess, menstrual irregularity or infertility, or it can be tailored according to individual requirements. But it is important to keep in mind that the effective management of PCOS requires a sustained multi-pronged strategy and a team of experts including gynecologist, dermatologist, physician, nutritionist, psychiatrist and a pediatrician for adolescent patients. Lifestyle modification in the form of regular exercise, healthy diet and regular sleeping habits forms an important part of the treatment. Pharmacologic agents may be used in a targeted manner to treat symptoms of androgen excess and menstrual irregularity. Many patients inquire regarding any surgical management for PCOS. The surgical treatment for PCOS is mainly useful for patients who are trying to conceive. In the early 1960s, open surgery in the form of ovarian wedge resection was used for the treatment of PCOS. But now, laparoscopic ovarian drilling is the mainstay. Laparoscopic ovarian surgery is considered the gold standard for treatment of PCOS. Let me explain to you in detail about this procedure. It is known as diagnostic hysterolaparoscopy with ovarian drilling. There are four parts in this procedure. Number one is hysteroscopy, in which we use a telescope with a camera which is inserted through the vagina into the uterus to look inside the uterus for any abnormalities like polyp, thickened endometrium or abnormal shape of the uterus. Second part is laparoscopy, in which camera is inserted through your navel into the abdomen to look at the uterus, fallopian tubes and ovaries. Any abnormalities detected during hysteroscopy or laparoscopy may be treated at the same sitting. Third part is chromoperturbation. It is a procedure in which we inject a dye into the uterus and look for its free flow through the fallopian tubes into the abdomen. The fourth part is ovarian drilling. The appearance of polycystic ovaries at laparoscopy is enlarged, pearly grey and with a thickened capsule. The polycystic ovaries are punctured at 4 to 5 sites using electrocautery or laser. This procedure reduces the androgen secreting stroma of the ovary, enhances ovulation and improves the response to ovulation induction post-procedure. It is found that laparoscopic ovarian drilling restores ovulation in almost 80 to 90% of the cases, and the effects of laparoscopic ovarian drilling may be sustained up to 9 years after the procedure. Let me tell you about the benefits of laparoscopy. This procedure is a daycare surgery. That means you can get admitted to the hospital early morning and you will be back home by evening, roughly 4 to 5 hours after the procedure. It is performed under general anesthesia. It is not an open surgery. There are maybe 2 to 3 incisions on the abdomen, roughly half a centimeter each. Hence, there is less pain and faster recovery. There is no need for bed rest and you would be back to your routine the very next day. Another important advantage of laparoscopy is that it gives an actual and complete picture of the reproductive organs and associated problems, which is much better than other scanning modalities. Following diagnostic hysterolaparoscopy and ovarian drilling, further treatment for conception may be in the form of ovulation induction, intrauterine insemination or IVF. If you have PCOS, do not lose hope. Though PCOS requires a sustained and prolonged treatment, it can be tailored according to individual needs. Many patients are scared to speak openly about this condition and ask for help. But it is always better to speak to your doctor and allay your fears rather than suffering alone. I hope you find this information helpful. If you have any further doubts, please approach your doctor and clarify your doubts at the earliest. Thank you.